biology.
So welcome there to this class, whereby in this class we are going to discuss about the heart. So what is the heart? As you can see on the diagram, so this is an organ that pumps blood to all parts of the body. So that is the heart. The function is to pump blood. So what are the adaptations of the heart to its function? So the first adaptation, we'll see that it is enclosed by a strong pericardial membrane, which mainly secretes a fluid that lubricates it as it continuously pumps blood. So for the heart, we also see that it has valves which prevent the backflow of blood. So on the upper part of the heart, it has semilunar valves on both sides, while on the lower part, it has the tricuspid and the bicuspid valve. So the easiest way to understand these valves is by the acronym TB, whereby on this side is tricuspid, on the other side is bicuspid valve. So the other adaptations of the heart, we see that it is made up of cardiac muscles that contract and relax without fatigue or requiring any nervous stimulation. So it basically works automatic. So the other adaptations will say that it is divided into four chambers, whereby the right side is mainly concerned with pulmonary circulation, while the left side is mainly concerned with systemic circulation, as we had seen on the previous classes. So the other adaptation of the heart, we see that it is connected to blood vessels, which mainly deliver blood and bring blood back to the heart. So the aorta is the main artery that takes blood to the rest of the body, while vena cava is the main vein that brings blood back to the heart. So also for the heart, we see that it has a very muscular septum, which mainly separates the oxygenated blood from the deoxygenated blood. So not to forget that again, it is joined by a very strong aorta that delivers blood to all parts of the body as the other adaptation. So the other adaptation, we'll see that it has a very strong left ventricle. Why is the left ventricle thicker than the right ventricle? This is a reason as to why it must pump blood to the rest of the body and then back to the heart. And that's the reason why the left ventricle is always thicker than the right ventricle. The right ventricle is only concerned with pumping blood to the lungs and back to the heart, while the left ventricle is mainly concerned with pumping blood to the rest of the body and then back to the heart. And that's why it is very strong and very thick. So lastly, we see that the heart is made up of different pacemakers, including the sinoatrial node, which mainly regulates the pumping mechanism of the heart. So let's now look at the pumping mechanism of the heart as a subtopic. So how does the heart pump? So we see that the mammalian heart mainly undergoes two main processes, whereby the first process is called systole and the next process is called the diastole. So during the systole phase of the process, we see that the ventricles contract to force blood into the arteries from the heart. And again, during the diastole phase, the muscles of the ventricles will relax, thereby increasing the volume of each ventricular chamber. And therefore, as this one happens, the pressure will decrease. So you see that the cuspid valves, that is the tricuspid valve or the bicuspid valve, they will open, allowing oxygenated blood to flow in the left ventricle from the left auricle. Whereby, looking at the right side, you see that the tricuspid valve will open to let blood flow in the right ventricle from the right auricle. So during systole, the ventricular muscles will contract, that is the left ventricle and the right ventricle. So the ventricular muscles will contract, the tricuspid and the bicuspid valve will close as blood will be forced out of the heart. So what you should know here is that during the systole phase, the tricuspid and the bicuspid valve will close and the semilunar valves will open to let the blood flow inside or the blood flow onto them. So volume of the ventricles in this phase decreases and the pressure increases to force blood out of the heart to the lungs via the pulmonary artery and the rest of the body via the aorta from the left side. So lastly, we see that both systole and diastole make up the heartbeat, because if you feel your heartbeat, you'll feel that there are always two beats. So the first beat is for the systole, and then the lower beat is always for the diastole. So away from that, let's now look at the diseases of the circulatory system. Because the circulatory system comprises of different diseases, whereby the first disease is thrombosis. So what is thrombosis? So basically, thrombosis is the formation of a blood clot, which is always referred to as thrombus in the blood vessels. So mainly when the coronary artery is blocked, and then in the previous classes we had seen that the coronary artery is the main artery that supplies the heart with the nutrients. So when this artery is blocked, it may suddenly result to heart attack. So when the blood vessels or the capillaries of the brain is blocked, it may result to stroke. So also, this disease thrombosis may also be brought by the intake of excess cholesterol in the blood. So this may lead to the clogging of the coronary artery or the blood vessels of the brain, which may suddenly lead to heart attack and stroke respectively. So let's look at the other disease, which is called arteriosclerosis. So this is mainly brought by the calcification of the arteries, making them to lose their elasticity. So it is mainly characterized by growth of fibrous connective tissues in the arterial walls, leading to the loss of elasticity in these blood vessels and may suddenly result to arteriosclerosis disease. So it can be treated by different ways, or it can be prevented by different ways, whereby the first one is taking food which is low in cholesterol. So always take food low in cholesterol. Also, it may be prevented or controlled by regular exercise in order to keep the heart muscles active and very strong. And then the other preventive measure is avoid obesity nature, because the obesity nature is always characterized by different circulatory system diseases. So the next one, let's look at varicose veins as the other disease of the circulatory system, whereby you see that this is the swelling of the leg muscles, thus becoming flabby due to the failure of some valves to function properly. Therefore, some fluid will build on the blood vessels, thereby leading to the swelling of the leg muscles. So it can also be prevented by wearing surgical socks or regular exercise. So let's now look at hypertension, or the layman's term, high blood pressure. So it mainly results when the heartbeat is above 140 to 90 millimeters of mercury reading. So the numerator is always the diastole pressure, while the denominator, which is 90, is always the systolic pressure. However, we see that the normal blood pressure should range about 120 to 80 millimeters of mercury. So this disease, the high blood pressure disease, is mostly common to individuals who are above 40 years of age. So the reason for high blood pressure is mainly attributed to the intake of large amounts of salt, thus increasing the blood viscosity. So the blood will be heavier than normal. So the heart will really struggle to pump blood through the blood vessels. Also, you should know that the intake of too much cholesterol will coat the arteries, making them even narrower, therefore increasing the blood pressure. So basically, high blood pressure, it causes destruction of very many vital organs in the body, such as the brain or the heart or the liver. So this disease may mainly be controlled by avoiding too much cholesterol in the diet, regular exercise, and avoiding too much fatty foods. So let's now meet on the next class as we now discuss more on the blood. Biology.